Welcome to Gutter Trash, episode 368, Genius, by Stephen T. Siegel and Teddy Christensen. My name is Eric.
And I'm Jason.
Hello.
What up, dog?
Nothing.
Yeah. Well. All right. We don't often read about geniuses.
Nope.
I mean, when you are a genius.
Sure.
You don't need to read about other geniuses.
Why would you?
we're clearly geniuses.
Mm-hmm. This is going poorly.
I think, okay. We can do it. We can do it. We can do this.
All right. Fucking genius. Okay. Let's restart.
Okay.
Okay. I'm not going to actually restart. Okay. I'm just going to reset.
Okay.
Okay.
All right. Let's do it.
Hello. Welcome to Gutter Trash episode 368. Genius by Stephen T. Siegel and Teddy Christensen. My name is Eric.
I'm Jason. What up, dog?
What up?
That was a better energy level.
It was, yeah.
Well, it's kind of a rainy March 1st.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, it's the day where we have to pay our bills and it's kind of gloomy outside. Our energy level is low.
Yeah, yeah.
And, so it's understandable.
And we've had little food.
Yeah, a little food. Yeah. We were just talking about that.
Right.
I've eaten some kale and some peanut butter.
Right. I had a hot dog.
Wow.
So not only little food, but horrible food.
In your case or both?
Both.
Okay. I actually liked mine. Especially the kale. Peanut butter is okay.
Yeah. But I think it's National Peanut Butter Day.
What? Every day is like a national day now.
I know. The internet sucks.
We were talking about that at work yesterday because they were talking about doing like window displays or something. They're like, hey, it's like Charlie Brown Day coming up and all these other days.
Right.
I'm like, what? I've never even heard of any of these days.
Why can't a day just be a day?
Man.
Right?
Wow. That's like something that Einstein would have said.
I once got into a very involved argument with a friend of mine who wanted to celebrate Albert Einstein's birthday.
Okay.
Like, you know, 10 years ago.
Okay.
He'd been dead for a very long time.
Very long time.
Yeah. And my argument is that he's dead. Mm-hmm. Why do that?
Right. Plus, I'm guessing your friend didn't know Albert Einstein.
No, personally.
No,
yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. That I'm aware of.
That you're aware of.
Sure. Right, yeah. And again, this argument happened so long ago, I don't remember the details of it, but he was very insistent, and I was very insistent, and we just got into it.
Did he end up celebrating without you?
Probably.
Oh.
Yeah. I'm betting he's never remembered when Albert Einstein's birthday is
from that day forward. Yeah. If he did have a big party and hire like a band, he should have hired a DJ named MC Squared. That would have been amazing.
Do you think there's a DJ or there a rapper named MC Squared?
Has to be. I mean, I don't know that there is, but God, there has to be, right? There has to be a four of them.
Right?
Yeah.
So we're not just willy-nilly talking about Albert Einstein.
That's not our wheelhouse.
Nope, because as I've just described, I want nothing to do with Albert Einstein.
At least not his birthday party shenanigans.
Exactly.
I'm guessing Albert Einstein didn't celebrate his birthday while he was alive. I'm just guessing that. Like, he seems like the type that'd be like, I've got better things to do.
I feel like he's probably the type of guy who probably every day was a party.
Well, okay, yeah. I mean, yeah. You've seen him.
If if the movie IQ is anything to be believed. I don't know. I never saw that movie.
I've never seen it either. I actually have a copy sitting on a bookshelf at my house, but I've never watched it. It was a gift from my boss from years ago.
I remember it being at the movie theater when I worked there.
Oh, yeah?
And,
Walter Matthau?
Walter Matthau played Albert Einstein. Tim Robbins and Meg Ryan.
I know Meg Ryan's in it. I think that's the reason my boss likes it. He has a crush on Meg Ryan.
Sure.
So he loves that movie, and he kept telling me I should watch it. Yeah. And he would ask me every so often, like, have you seen that movie yet? And I was like, no. And then one day I just showed up at work, and he had a DVD copy. And I still haven't watched it.
you should take the
maybe,
time.
Maybe I'll watch it.
Yeah. Maybe we can do that some drawing night.
Yeah. Okay.
I don't want to watch it.
I don't want to watch it either.
As much as I love Walter Matthau.
The last movie my boss had me watch was A Walk in the Woods with Walter Matthau and Nick Nolte.
That doesn't make any sense at all.
It's
Walter Matthau has been dead for at least 10 years.
What did I say? Walter Matthau?
Yeah.
Oh, we were just talking about him. Yeah. Robert Redford.
That makes more sense.
And Nick Nolte. Okay. Yeah. So he bought me that movie as well.
Uh-huh.
And he just loaned it to me. And I actually watched it, and it was pretty bad. Like, it was one of those things, like, maybe when I'm 60, I might, like, okay.
Right.
You know, I get it now. But it's just about two old guys going on a really long walk together.
That sounds boring.
It sounds like something I would be into, though. But it's supposed to be kind of, like, cute and, like, you know, like, life-affirming and all those things. And
with Nick Nolte?
Nick Nolte.
He is the opposite of cute and life-affirming.
What? I think on his IMDb page it says cute and life-affirming actor Nick Nolte has been in 87 films. And Christian Schaal's in it, too.
Okay.
Who else? I don't know. That's about it. It's not great, but like I said, maybe I'll watch it when I'm 60.
Okay.
And maybe I'll appreciate it.
So 20 years.
Yeah, 20 years. We'll
be watching A Walk in the Woods again.
I'll have to find a DVD player that works. Yeah, sure. I'll be going to all the Goodwills.
Those won't
exist. There's no Goodwill left by then.
Oh, we won't be alive in 20 years anyway.
No, that's right.
The world's going to burn.
Oh, I hope not.
In nuclear fire.
It's possible.
Albert Einstein help develop the nuclear bomb.
That's true. And here we are, talking about the book Genius.
Yeah.
Sort of about Albert Einstein, but not really.
Not particularly. He's in it.
Yeah.
He's a sort of a secondary character of sorts. So Genius.
Yeah.
It's the story of a guy.
Mr. Ted something or other, who's a physicist.
He is our titular genius.
Yeah.
Yeah. Basically, the book starts out, he sort of describes his childhood of being a genius as a kid. And, he had some pretty big and bold ideas when he was younger. And then we flash forward to present day, where he's now a middle-aged man married with two teen kids, and I guess everything, even genius can kind of,
it fades.
I wouldn't say fade, but just sort of, you know, everybody has their prime.
Right.
And he is sort of past his already.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, he is. U2 post Joshua Tree in this book.
You talking U2 to me?
Yeah. Sure. he is still probably a very, very intelligent man.
Oh, yeah.
And he's in the scientific community, but he just hasn't really had any, like,
breakthroughs or big theories or anything like that.
Yeah, and he's maybe being being edged out of his position at work, maybe, if he doesn't come up with something good.
Right. So he's got a lot of anxiety. And so that's pretty much this story. There's a man who is suffering sort of some sort of a midlife crisis and a lot of anxiety and some family troubles.
Yeah, because like his kid is learning about sex. Yeah. He's a teenager now. His wife is very ill.
Yeah.
Which is never a good thing.
Yep.
And he is worried that if he doesn't come up with a great idea at work, he might not have his job long and might not have the financial means to help support his wife while she's going through whatever treatments she needs. Right. So he's kind of got a lot of pressure from all sides here.
Right. And so while he's going through that, he is also dealing with his wife's father, who lives with him. He's a very old man in a wheelchair who has some form of dementia or Alzheimer's.
He's kind
of
impish. He kind of seems like a...
No, he's definitely he's an asshole.
Yeah, he's an asshole, and he's like this little man, and he's kind of like mean and strange.
Yeah. And he just happens to let slip that back in the 30s he knew Albert Einstein.
Briefly.
Yeah. Briefly. Very briefly.
He was like a MP or something?
Yeah, he's basically Albert Einstein's security guard. Of sorts, when he came to the States, I guess. Mm-hmm. And of course, Ted doesn't believe him because he's a crazy old man.
Right. And he says stuff all the time.
Right.
Not knowing what year it is or right. whatever.
But it is confirmed that, he did indeed know Albert Einstein. And not only that, Albert Einstein told him a huge secret.
Yeah. Yeah, apparently Einstein, as you do when you're Einstein, you come up with new breakthrough theories all the time, and he had a new one, and he was worried that it was too much for the people to know, but he couldn't just let it stay in his head. But he knew if he shared it with the scientific community, it would be implemented.
Right.
So he decided just to share it with this one security guard and tell them never to tell another soul.
Yep. So Ted now basically spends the rest of the book attempting to pry this secret from this senile old man's head.
Right. Which could have been a really great dark comedy.
Sure.
Like a slapstick adventure.
I could see this like in a Home Alone style.
Yeah, man, right? Yeah, he's like elaborately creating scenarios where the guy thinks... Yeah, he's trying to set up like, oh, this is a dream. Tell me. You're dreaming. Tell me about the Einstein thing here in your dream.
He basically, Ted thinks that this is, if he can get this unknown theory of Albert Einstein's and present it as his own, then maybe this would be the key to saving his job.
Seems like that would keep your job if you
sure
had an Einstein level, breakthrough theory at your job as a physicist. Seems like that'd be good.
Probably. I mean, neither of us know anything about physics or being a physicist or a genius or even above average intelligence.
No. Maybe even average. I don't even know if we know about that, really. Probably. Yeah.
Slight tangent, but partially related. Do you remember those old Marvel Universe trading cards that came out in, like, 1990?
Oh, I loved those things.
Whatever, yeah. I believe it was the second series where they started putting, like, character stats on the back of the cards.
Yeah.
And so I got those, and my friends and I were looking through them, and we came across the Absorbing Man card. And on the back, it had all their stats, and it had, mental, prowess or whatever. And the Absorbent Man's was, what was it? It was, like, barely efficient or something like that.
Barely efficient.
And that became sort of a running joke between my friends and I.
Like, you're barely efficient.
Barely efficient.
Yes. Poor absorbing man.
Yep.
I always liked that character.
He's kind of a cool character. Mm-hmm. Ironically, played by Nick Nolte in the Hulk movie.
Wow. I bet he was a cute, cute version of absorbing man. What was it? Cute in life for him?
Yes.
You know, I remember Nick Nolte from a very young age. He's one of the first actors I remember seeing in a movie, honestly, when I was like a child.
Really?
And he was just like, just horrible garbage on the screen, you know, with like his cursing and his smoking. And I just remember being like, wow, this is a scary dude.
Was it 48 Hours?
Probably 48 Hours. Down
Mount Beverly Hills.
I saw both of those very young. Like, yeah. I remember that's the first time I ever heard the Talking Heads was on that Down and Out in Beverly Hills movie. Yeah. Yeah, he's, I mean, I actually kind of like him as an actor, but I remember being like, oh, like, this guy's just a piece of junk when I was a kid. He was not cute.
Not far from wrong. Oh, genius. So, yeah, so, I thought the book was okay.
Yeah. Yeah, me too. Yeah, me too.
But not horrible either.
I'd say it was good. It was okay to good.
Yeah.
Like it was definitely worth reading and I liked it, but and just I don't know. Yeah, it wasn't amazing. But I liked it.
Like, I think
I'm flipping through it now. The art is so good.
The art is incredible.
Yeah. I think he's amazing.
Teddy Christensen is definitely fantastic. And there's kind of, like, I won't say wide array, but there's definitely, you know, a variety of art styles that he presents in his book.
Yeah.
You know, from really cartoony to also just super abstract.
Yeah. Yeah, there's a sequence in there, where he basically is illustrating geniusness.
Yeah.
And, like, how do you do that?
Right.
Like, there's no words.
No. Nope.
And it's just, like, six pages of just insanity. And
I wonder what the script for that read like.
Yeah. It's probably like, do your best, Teddy.
Yeah.
And, is Ted based on Teddy Christensen at all?
I have no idea.
Okay.
Yeah. I mean, Teddy Christensen, I would argue, is a genius.
Yeah.
Just a different type of genius. Unless he also is, like, physicist as well. He just happens to make comics in his spare time.
I don't think he is. But he does, Teddy Christensen in his thank you says, dedicated to Hope for being there as constant support. And Hope is the name of the wife, Ted's wife in the book. So I don't know.
Huh.
So
I don't know. I don't know either. Yeah, it could be. I mean, I know the creative team's one of their previous collaborations was about Steven Seagal.
Yeah,
and his life, but that also read a lot more autobiographical than this does.
Right. Yeah, I thought it was. Yeah, I thought that was weird, but
could be loosely based on his own life a little, at least. Modeled after him and his family, maybe.
I love the way he uses just kind of muted colors all the time.
Yeah.
Like these, like, grays and browns. And
I will say, occasionally, there are spots where it's hard to read.
Yeah.
Because of the background. Mostly, yeah.
Yeah, there's different, like, fonts for different people and different... I mean, sometimes it's, like, the narration is pretty, like, normal-looking. Like,
right.
And the rest of it kind of looks handwritten.
Yeah. And then sometimes it's like on a colored background with like a colored caption box. And,
right.
Yeah. But I made it through.
Yeah.
I also think, you know, maybe I'm unfairly comparing this to, you know, the other book by them that I read.
Right. And
fucking love.
Oh, sure.
Which is It's a Bird, the aforementioned autobiographical story.
Yeah. That was really good.
Yeah, and yeah. This is perfectly fine. Yeah, it just wasn't that.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. I think it's good, but if I was telling somebody about this, I'd be like, man, you should read this. But if you haven't read It's a Bird,
right.
That's what you should really read.
Right.
And maybe, I don't know, I haven't read House of Secrets, but I've heard that's good, too.
I enjoyed House of Secrets. Mm-hmm. I've read quite a bit of Stephen Siegel's work.
They've worked together a lot, haven't they, these two? Or is it the only three things?
There's at least another thing that I know of, because I looked at it on Amazon, and like, I think I put it on like my I'll Buy This Later list here.
Right.
I can't remember the name of it offhand. And I don't have my tiny computer with me.
Yeah. But Steven Seagal's done a lot more like movie work than comic work with all of his like martial arts movies.
Yeah, Hard to Kill.
Hard to Kill. Justice. Marked for Death.
Marked for Death.
That's a good one. My favorite is the one where he's on the boat.
That's Prestige.
It's good. Oh, that one's good too. I was thinking the one called On the Boat. No, you're right. It's Under Siege. Yeah. That's my favorite one.
One of his few only two-word titles.
Under Siege, yeah. Yeah, it's usually like a...
Three words.
It's a prepositional phrase.
I believe there was an interview with him once on Arsenio Hall's show where Arsenio pointed out that most of his movies are three words, and it's like something to something.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, he's great.
Yeah. How many times do you think Steven T. Siegel has heard this joke?
Oh, way too many.
Yeah. I hope he does not listen to this podcast. No. I was really hoping we were going to get away with not doing that.
I'm sorry.
It's all right. Well, he'll just groom his ponytail. And
Is that an urban legend that his ponytail got stolen on, like, a talk show? Because he had, like, cut it off. But he, like, had it with him for some reason, like in the green room, and someone stole it while he was getting interviewed by Arsenio Hall or Dave Letterman or whoever. Is that an urban legend? I've
never heard of that.
I've heard people say that, but I don't know if it's true or not.
I wouldn't doubt that.
Who wouldn't want to buy his ponytail?
Right. I mean, it's got to be worth more than he as an actual person is.
Oh, man.
Because he's fucking terrible.
I've heard that.
He is a garbage human.
I don't know anything about him, but I mean, you just assume so.
Yeah. But I'm sure Steven T. Siegel is probably a great guy.
He seems great.
Yeah.
I mean,
he's a talented writer.
I've
enjoyed much of his work.
Yeah.
He made the X-Men readable for a short period of time.
Did he do the X-Men?
Late 90s, yeah.
Okay, I didn't know that.
Or early 2000s.
Late what 90s. Series did he do?
I believe he wrote Uncanny.
Okay.
Yeah.
Wow.
Him and Joe Kelly were doing double teaming the X-Men.
Nice.
I think Siegel worked with Pacello. The Uncanny.
I don't think I read any of those. Yeah.
Yeah. I got into that again because of those two, and then they did not last very long, and then I bailed again until Grant Morrison.
I would like to see Siegel and Christensen do a run on the X-Men.
Oh, that would be amazing.
Yeah, that would be cool.
I don't think Steven Siegel does much Marvel or DC work anymore.
That's cool, though. I mean, like, as much as I always am interested to see people with a very distinct style do a superhero book, I would still rather read another, like, book like Genius from them.
Oh, absolutely.
But I would read if they did a... You know, like a Iron Man story or whatever.
Oh, sure.
I read that.
Absolutely, yeah. I always want to see, like, you know... Yeah, like you said, like distinct voices, like, work on, like, something super mainstream.
Oh, yeah.
Just to see, like, what they would do with
it. Yeah, because it might actually be interesting.
Right, like, you know, Ted McKeever doing, you know, like a Batman story.
Right.
You know, it's like...
Of course.
Yeah.
Sign me up.
Right. Yeah, I mean, I think Siegel, like, he's one of the co-founders of the Man of Action studio.
It's like a cartoon studio.
Yeah. They created, like, Ben 10 and, you know, other cartoons that I don't know of. But, you know, so I'm sure he's doing fine.
Yeah, that's cool.
that's probably afforded him the ability to do stories like this. Yeah.
That's awesome. And that's cool that Christensen still works with him too.
Yeah.
Just double checking to see when this was published. It was after Einstein died, that's for sure.
Yeah, that makes sense. That was like, what, 2015, something like that? So this came out in 2013. Or 2013, depending how you want to say that. And yeah, like I said, like there's that other book of theirs that I can't think of the title of. I'm sure I think that came out a couple years ago, so.
Another graphic novel standalone book.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was good. Basically, the rest of it that we, I guess we shouldn't spoil is just the nuances of how he deals with figuring out, you know, the thing he needs to figure out, like whether it is the key theory that Einstein whispered into Francis's ear 50 right. years ago, or if it's something else maybe he needs to figure out.
Right.
And that's kind of what this book is all about.
Yeah.
And it's pretty good.
Yeah. It's just, it's a nice, quiet sort of character study.
You know?
Like nothing huge, you know, nothing bombastic. It's just a good, solid book.
Yeah. And it has, like, it does kind of, like you said, it's quiet and it has this kind of slow pace to it, but not in a boring way. Like, I read the entire thing in one sitting because, it does just kind of, like, you know, move right along.
Right.
And, it's a good, it's got its own little world.
Yeah. I think, you know, one thing that I do really appreciate about it is that, like, there are so many places in this book where, like, you know, it could veer off into, like, a cliche sort of territory. You know, especially, like, with a family drama, like, you know, you expect, like, certain things to happen just based on every movie that you've ever seen.
Yes. Right.
And it really doesn't. Everybody is super likable and they all do their best to just sort of, you know, get along, even, you know, cranky old grandpa, you know.
Yeah.
And you know, it's just really solid.
Yeah. And beautiful to look at.
And exactly. Yep. Art cred.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, so I liked it.
Same. But again, like you said, if you haven't read It's a Bird
by these same it's the guys. Same two dudes, and it is a much better book.
Yeah. And it may be just because that one reads more personal than this one.
Yeah.
Yeah. So like, more at stake for the writer than you know, him. Seemingly just telling a story.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Hmm.
Yeah. Not much else to really say.
Not really. It's a very short book.
Yeah, it is.
So, you know, like, yeah, hard to talk about without just giving away everything.
I know I had a bookmark because I was like, yeah, I mean, it's 120-something pages, but I was like, I sit down to read it. It's like, oh, I've got a bookmark in case, like, you know, there's a chapter break or something where I'm like, there's not really any chapter breaks.
No.
It just kind of goes and goes. And it is a fairly quick read.
Yeah, I think I read it in, you know, one sitting, yeah, which is rare for me. And read it at home as well. Also rare for me.
Nice.
So, yeah, genius.
Check it out.
Check it out. Like I mentioned last week, I wound up getting it on Amazon for a penny.
Nice.
So, you know.
That's totally worth way more than a penny.
Uh-huh, yeah. I mean, you know, it was $5 shipping, but, you know.
It's totally worth $5.
Totally worth $5, yeah. Absolutely. Especially, I think it's a $20 book.
Is it?
18.
Still. Yeah. It's up there. Yeah. Not bad.
Yeah.
Thanks, guys, for making a good book.
Indeed.
I'll see what you've done. I'm sure they've done something else.
I'm sure, yeah. I think this will definitely get me to pull the trigger on that other book that maybe I'll look up in the break.
Yeah. I'm curious.
Yeah.
Even if the listener's asleep by now.
Sure.
I'd like to know what it is.
Yeah. Well, they could listen to this probably heavy metal song.
Who knows, right?
Yeah. And then you yelling at them when we come back.
Yeah. So you're not going to see if there's a rapper named MC Squared to put in here?
Maybe I will. We don't know. I'm just saying 90% of the time we wind up using like some sort of metal rock sure. song. Because that's what we're into.
It's Satan's music.
And we are Satanists.
He is our leader.
Yeah. All right, let's take a break.
Welcome back to Gutter Trash.
Oh, sorry.
You stepped on my only line. So we found out all kinds of stuff, right?
Yeah, we did.
First of all, there are several versions of an artist out there named MC Squared. Some of them more talented than others.
I don't know that we proved that.
One of them is clearly not talented at all. None of them are ones that I would be terribly excited to see perform live. But there's a guy that does some beatboxing under the name.
We watched all 30 minutes of that.
It went on for a while.
Yeah, it did.
It was like 4 minutes, but it felt long. Somehow he was not booed off the stage at Apollo, which, you know, that happens.
Yeah, and he was a white guy.
Yeah.
I was totally expecting it. It didn't happen.
What, the booing?
Yeah.
Do you mean because he was white or just because he was kind of boring?
Because he was awful.
Yeah. It was okay.
Yeah.
But yeah, so yeah, there's plenty of MC Squareds out there.
Yeah. And the mystery Teddy Christensen Steven Seagal collab that I couldn't think of the name is called The Red Diary : The Red Diary.
Yes.
It's apparently some sort of weird graphic novel experiments.
Yeah.
And I'm very interested in it, and I probably will wind up getting a copy.
Sweet.
Yeah. So that was that.
Cool.
We learned some stuff.
We did learn stuff.
Yeah. Are we geniuses?
No.
Yet?
Okay. No. We are not. No. Yeah, we're just a couple of dudes.
Yeah, still.
Yep. Yep. Forevermore.
So what's up?
Nothing much. Nothing much. You know, just do my thing. I went to a comic book convention.
Oh, yeah?
On Sunday. I worked at one.
It's not a real convention.
That's true. Well, I mean, it was. It was a real convention. There's, you know, it's more of a, you know, exhibitor convention than it is like, or more of a dealer convention than an exhibitor convention. So it's mostly just comic shops selling their shit.
Yeah.
Mostly. There's some artists there.
There are a couple.
But it's, yeah. And I didn't, like, I ventured away from my table for all of, I'd say a total of 20 minutes on, like, the three adventures I got away from the table.
Right.
Because we were pretty busy. And I looked at, like, dollar boxes at, like, four different tables. And I, like, the coolest thing I found was, like, some 70s and early 80s Captain Americas for a dollar.
I thought you were going to scamp in victory.
Oh,
I was going to fucking punch you.
Why, do you know anybody that needs one? No, but I didn't see anything that I was like, I got to go home with this, so. Yeah, it was okay.
Yeah.
I mean, we sold a bunch of shit, so that was cool.
That's cool. I had no money, so I could not go, but I really wanted to. Now I gotta wait another 3-4 months.
Yeah. Oh, hey, the Gym City Comic Con is next month.
That's true.
That's a big show.
That is, yeah. I think I'm gonna be there? I don't know yet. I'll find out tomorrow sure.
I'm sure I'll be there in some capacity.
I'll be there in some capacity, yeah. but in the capacity of being at a table, not having a table, mind you, but being at a table. Yeah,
right.
I'll find out for sure tomorrow if I'm going to be doing that or not.
Cool.
Yeah. But yeah, and I'm sure if I'll get away and try to find me some Captain Victories.
There's usually some pretty sweet deals at that show.
Hopefully. Yeah,
I will.
Hopefully I'll have my tax return by then too.
Oh, so, yeah. Perfect. Perfect.
So I can blow it all.
Yeah, that's the American way. I will be there maybe one day, and I'll probably be working at the shop the other day because everybody wants to work there one day. Mm-hmm. So just to switch it around, make it fun for everybody.
Yeah. You're not going to be at the sparkle table?
I don't think I will be.
No. Ooh.
No.
Rebelling.
Oh.
Against your master.
Sparkle had a table right next to the Mavericks table, which I requested at the convention over the weekend. It was cool because we got to hang out the whole time, but, yeah, I didn't work at the Sparkle table at all. They always have plenty of people, so. Sparkle is the local comics company here in Dayton, Ohio.
It pays in fun.
Pays in fun, and hey, it's fun. It's fun. I enjoy it.
But can you buy beer with fun?
I've done fun things that got me free beers before. That's true.
All right, can you buy bread with fun?
Man, baby, the way I make it fun, I can get anything I want. Kind of fun that exudes out of my body here.
So the next time I do a Jim and Dan show, can I request to be next to the Mavericks booth?
Sure.
Sweet.
Yeah. I'm good. Yeah, because they usually have a separate room where all the artist tables are.
Yeah.
Not always, but usually.
It used to be in the main room with everybody else.
Yeah.
And then they started moving everybody out into the hallway where it's nobody wants to go.
Yeah. I mean, and I'll even say this, I mean, like, I'm even... you know, an amateur struggling comic artist myself, and even I didn't stop at any of those tables when I had to, like, pass through that zone to go to the restroom.
Right.
Because I was like, I'm working, and I need to go to the restroom, and then I need to get back to my table.
Right.
And I'm not even going to look at the stuff so I don't get, like, pulled in by the tractor beam of those sad eyes.
Right, know? Right.
And, and so I just briskly walked by looking at my phone as if, you know, I was, you know, answering some important message.
Sure, sure.
But,
you were.
The call of nature.
Yes.
Yeah. But I only went through there, yeah, the one trip back and forth just to go to the restroom. So hopefully, I mean, gosh, I hope all these people do okay, because, like, I've been there. I know it sucks if you're off in another little room.
Oh, yeah.
Like, it's not great.
Nope.
Because people usually just walk right through and go to the main
floor. Even at all.
Yeah. Well, you have to at that show. Okay. Yeah. You actually have to walk through that room to get into the main room, which that's cool.
Yeah.
But people usually just walk right through it.
Oh, yeah. Because they want them sweet, sweet dollar boxes.
Yeah. Oh, God. Maybe there's a Batman in there. Oh, my God. There's a Batman in the dollar box. Everyone in! But that's, yeah, it was fun.
Yeah.
That's what I did over the weekend.
I'm glad you had fun.
You would have not enjoyed it. There was nothing good there. Yeah, you didn't miss anything. But, I don't know.
Yeah.
What else exciting is happening in the world? Anything? Comic news, anything? I heard Kevin Smith almost died this week.
Yeah.
I'm glad he's exciting. I'm glad he didn't.
Oh.
Yeah, I like Kevin Smith. You know, he seems cool.
He does not.
I don't like a lot of his work, but I like some of it. And
I liked his early movies.
And he seems alright.
I think he seems like a massive douchebag.
Really?
Oh, yeah. He is the worst example of a comic book fan.
You think?
Oh, yeah. He's the worst stereotype of guy who likes comics and guy who hangs around other people who like comics.
I don't know that much about him, but from the interviews I've seen, I thought he was alright.
And also, he's definitely one of those guys who, you know, like a month ago or so, when we discovered that Slayer was going on their farewell tour, and we briefly thought about possibly going to see the show here in Ohio.
Sure.
And, you know, you're just like, yeah, I'm all for that, except for the fact that there will be Slayer fans there.
Right, yeah.
That's me and Kevin Smith. I could probably be ambivalent about Kevin Smith, but his fucking fans.
Oh, okay.
The worst.
Is it just because they're obnoxious about him, like, being a genius, or?
Yeah. Uh-huh. Yeah. I'm just gonna flat out say it. I don't like Kevin Smith.
Yeah.
Glad he's still alive, you know, because I don't wish ill upon the man.
Sure.
Who knows? Maybe this heart attack will make him reevaluate some of his decisions in life, and he won't be making any more shitty Canadian-based horror movies.
Oh, man, that was a bad movie.
Go back to, you know, sort of the indie character comedy dramas that he was kind of perfecting at a point.
Right, yeah.
And then totally bailed on.
Right. Yeah, Tusk was very disappointing. I watched it, and, I was very disappointed.
Yeah, I have no desire to see that. Apparently, Yoga Hosers is maybe one of the worst movies ever made.
I've never seen that.
Yeah, that's his follow-up to Tusk.
Oh, no. Yeah. Isn't it like a sequel somehow?
It's
like the same girls in the shop or something.
Yeah, something like that, yeah.
And
yeah.
I have heard of that.
Yeah. But, you know, like people shit on Jersey Girl all the time. I think that's his best movie.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it was really good, I thought. It, you know, was really well acted.
I still haven't seen that one.
Yeah.
Is that Ben Affleck?
Ben Affleck, and I think people shit on it because it was the whole Ben Affleck, Jennifer Lopez thing.
Okay.
She's barely in the movie, and it's honestly just a really sweet, well-done story.
Hmm.
And George Carlin.
I like that guy.
And, you know, and I like Mallrats and Clerks and Chasing Amy, but
Zack and Miri make a porno?
Never saw that one.
I like that one. Yeah. I laughed uncontrollably in some of the scenes in that
movie. But yeah, then he did Cop Out. And then,
I never saw that. I heard that was terrible.
Yeah.
Huh. He probably made some good money on that, though.
I'm sure he did. So, hope he did. Yeah. Apparently it's bought him a podcasting empire.
Yeah. See, that's cool.
Sure. All I know, okay, so other than that, last year, 2 years ago? When did Suicide Squad come out?
It's probably been 2 years, yeah.
He and Jeff Johns co-hosted like a TV special, basically promoting all the DC stuff coming out. And I never wanted to strangle two people so much more in my life. And the fact that they were representing comic people everywhere,
right,
and just so snotty and obnoxious and just smarmy and bullshit.
Well, that's too bad. But hey, he's still alive.
Sure.
So that's good.
Yeah.
Like you said, maybe he'll make a movie about his experience. Or like at least informed by his experience.
Sure. Yeah.
That's cool.
Yeah.
We like slice of life stuff.
Sure.
Yeah.
Trying to think of anything else that's happened or that I've watched or read.
I read both issues of the Justice League Doom Patrol Milk Wars this week. Like the Justice League Doom Patrol and Doom Patrol Justice League.
Okay.
So
wait, what? I thought there was only the one.
There is like... No, there is...
Because it's a five-part series,
mm-hmm.
And, yeah. And I got my comic shipment in the other day, and the first four were in there, because the fifth one came out after my shipment came.
Sure.
But I'm pretty sure it was just one issue, right?
No, it was part one and part five. Those were the two Justice League Doom Patrol.
Oh, okay. So yeah. You read the first and the last part, mm-hmm. but none of the middle?
None of the middle.
Huh.
That's right.
Weird.
Well, the first one, because I was wondering about that, I was like, do I need to read the other ones? And I read the first one at the very end. It says, to be concluded in Doom Patrol Justice League. And I was like, oh, cool. So I bought that one. I read that one. And I mean, you can tell there's, like, you know, some stuff happened between the two. But I'll probably just read those two.
So I guess I can't pick the Milk Wars crossover for a gutter trash pick.
You could, and I'll finally read all the middle stuff. Because I enjoyed what I did read, so.
They all have those sweet, sweet Frank Quitely covers.
Oh, yeah, they are. I like that. I like those covers, actually.
Yeah.
Just those, like, people, singular figures descending from the sky figures. Covers.
So I desecrated a Jack Kirby comic earlier.
I saw that. What do you have against Jack Kirby?
He's terrible. Have you ever seen his art? What did he ever do for the comic industry?
Yeah. He created... Oh, who was it that he created? The Dingbats. Do you remember them? That's right. It's like a team book. I think that's... pretty much all he ever did.
Yeah, that sounds right. Yeah. Yeah, otherwise nothing.
Yeah. Yeah.
No, so a couple months ago, DC put out a fourth world omnibus that has every New Gods and Fourth World related comic that Kirby did in DC in the 70s.
Your Forever Peoples, yep. Mr. Miracle, all that shit.
Yep. And it's like a couple thousand pages long. There's like 52 comics collected in it.
Significant.
Significant amount. It's thick.
It looks like one of those Bibles that you only ever see on your grandma's coffee table.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, it's huge and it's heavy.
Yeah.
And has a misprint.
Yeah. Yeah, it's too bad.
And not like a small one, like significant.
And like one of the pages is missing and another page is accidentally put in its place.
Yeah. So, you know, people who read their books much faster than I ever do, noticed it, like, almost immediately when the book came out, and then, like, 2 weeks ago or whatever, DC finally announced that they're gonna go ahead and replace anybody's copy that wants it.
Mm-hmm.
with a corrected version. And I bought mine off Amazon. But everything that I read kept saying, you know, like, take it to your local comic store. But I didn't get mine through my local comic store. So I was very curious as to about what I could do with it. And, I asked you, and then you asked, your diamond rep, and apparently it's all gonna work out where I can return it through you and get a new copy.
Gosh, I hope so.
Hopefully, yeah, God willing. New God willing.
Yeah.
Wow. but unfortunately, they don't want the whole book back.
Yeah.
They just want the cover. It's a hardback. Which means I had to cut the hardbound cover off of this
giant tome.
Right.
And it doesn't just, like, come right off, because we send covers back, like, every month.
Sure.
For some reason or another. And it's kind of satisfying, even on books that I actually kind of like, just to rip the covers off of, like, 30 copies of Batman or Spider-Man or whatever.
Right.
But
that's easy. They're paper and held on by staples.
Yeah, you just pull them right off.
Yeah, yeah. This was not so easy. And it felt horrifying as I was doing it.
Right. It felt like you were, like, sneaking into the graveyard and, like, pissing on his grave and, like, tagging it, like, Eric was here. But yeah, you used a utility knife and you just tore that cover right off.
Yep. Still feel dirty.
Yeah. Feels a little wrong.
I mean, I guess ideally, we really should have done the sword idea.
Yeah, Eric owns the sword, and I suggested perhaps the only true way to, like, do this is to cleave it in twain with a sword.
Sure, sure.
But we opted for your safety.
Yeah, yeah. Because we're dumb.
Yeah, we could have easily...
We are not geniuses.
Injured one or both of ourselves by trying to use a sword.
Yeah.
But yeah, I hope, hopefully pretty soon you can have a page-by-page perfect copy of Fourth World Omnibus.
I hope so as well. Yeah, otherwise, you still haven't seen Black Panther?
Me neither. I actually just finally saw Ghost in the Shell this week, Scarlett Johansson movie. I've been wanting to see it. It was pretty good. I liked it. Have you seen it?
No. No desire.
It was pretty good. I enjoyed it.
Okay. I'm glad.
I've read the manga and seen the animated movie. I liked both.
Never did any of that. The only appealing thing about the Ghost in the Shell movie was that, you know, Scarlett Johansson looked mostly naked.
Yeah.
Beyond that, like, just zero interest.
Then that's not enough?
It's really not.
Okay. Yeah. We watched it last night. Liz and I, and she likes Scarlett Johansson a lot. We both enjoyed it. I wouldn't say it was, like, amazing, but I thought it was pretty good.
What about the fact that they hired a white actress to play a Japanese character?
It didn't really bother me.
Well, of course it did, because you're a white
man. I'm basically Harvey Weinstein.
Weinstein. That's why you're always jerking off into potted plants.
Does he do that?
He did that, yeah.
Oh, jeez. I did not know that.
He was jerking off in front of a lady and then... Into a potted plant.
Wow. Gosh. Awful. No, I think it's unfortunate, but I think it's a reality that they were like, well, this movie will do a lot better if...
But it didn't.
It didn't do
well. Bombed. Horrible.
Well, maybe they should have.
It got terrible reviews.
Maybe they should have had a Japanese actress.
Probably.
Yeah. But, she was good. I don't know. So. But, it could have been tweaked, I'm sure. But I enjoyed it. I thought it was pretty good. And that's probably the only comic book movie I'll watch this week. But I do want to see Black Panther pretty soon.
I believe I'm going to go see it tomorrow. So. Actually, I am going to go see it tomorrow. I already bought tickets.
Right.
So there's no way in fuck I'm not seeing that movie tomorrow.
I would have already seen it if a white girl would have played Black Panther.
Well, sure, yeah.
Like if Scarlett Johansson.
I think she's already
Black She's Widow. Black Widow, yeah.
When I'm already
It's another black Rachel character, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
Actually, she's Russian, right? Is that right?
Yeah.
So that is... So she is, like, stealing all the Russian and Japanese actress jobs. That bitch.
Nobody gives a fuck about Russians.
Yeah.
That movie Red Sparrow comes out tomorrow.
What's
well.
That?
It's essentially the Black Widow movie, but it's not, and it's got Jennifer Lawrence instead of Scarlett Johansson.
Oh, okay. Yeah. I think I did see a trailer.
Yeah, she's the Russian assassin lady spy. Can't get her ass her.
Well, that should be good. Fun. Yeah. I'm sure it's fun.
I'd like to see it. Since apparently we're never going to get a Black Widow movie.
It's weird. Yeah. Maybe they're looking at Ghost in the Shell numbers and thinking she can't carry a
Probably.
Action movie. But she was pretty good in it. Like, honestly. I mean, like, to be truthful, though, like, the main character is, like, mostly a robot. So, like, she speaks kind of tonally flat and things like that.
That's just Scarlett Johansson.
And that's what I'm saying. Like, she played that character great. and I actually don't mind Scarlett Johansson as an actress. I think she's fine. But
I think she used to be great.
Yeah, I was going to say, it seems like her older movies were much better.
Yeah, but like, her last... Everything that I've seen her in post-Avengers has been... She's not great in them.
She's just raking in the cash now.
Yeah, and also, you know, she sounds like she has a throat full of cigarettes.
Oh, maybe she smokes a lot.
I think she might.
It's too bad.
Her voice is raspier than mine right
now. Oh, man. No, ScarJo, no. Yeah, it was fine.
Yeah.
I enjoyed
I'll
it.
I'll never see it. Ever.
Would you watch the animated movie?
No.
Okay. That's good. That's
maybe.
Good. That's
I don't pretty know, maybe good. I would. But I definitely... Definitely
don't
zero interest them. In the live action. Yeah. Game. More open to the anime. Yeah.
See, that's good. Yeah. And we'll end on a there. Positive note.
Okay. We can still end on a positive note. I watched the movie Creed.
Oh, yeah. Oh, man, a biopic about that band. I yep. love that song, Higher. It's yep. so good.
You know, just the story of Scott Stapp's struggles.
That's what they were going to call it, but they thought it would be a tongue twister.
It is.
Scott Stapp's struggles. Wow. Just call it Creed.
Yeah. Yeah.
It makes sense. That was pretty good.
Creed. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's the Rocky spinoff of sorts. Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's incredibly good. Yeah. Directed by the guy who's directing the Black Panther movie.
Nice.
Trying to think if I watched anything else. I've just been catching up on TV. People, if you're not watching the show Counterpart, you're missing out.
Oh, which one is that?
That sounds is with J.K. Simmons.
Oh, yeah, that looks great.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah that does look good.
Yeah, otherwise, I got nothing.
I'll watch that.
I read a couple of old Kirby comics over the week.
Nice.
Like a random issue of like the original X-Men run and like a random issue of like his original Fantastic Four.
Nice. Catching up on Kirby.
Yeah.
That should be your blog title.
No, I'm good. Yeah, so
well,
speaking of comics.
I got a comic in mind for us to read.
Is it by Jack Kirby?
It's not.
Okay. I'm out.
Oh.
I'm only reading Jack Kirby comics.
Well, I mean, chances are, if I pulled a comic out of my collection, 1 in 5 would probably be, or if either of our collections at this point, you know.
Yeah, my Kirby collection has grown into a small child.
It is. It's taller. I've seen smaller children. I'm looking at it right now. I can see it. But, I was thinking we could read an Aftershock comic called Animosity.
Okay. Heard of it.
There's actually several versions of this, like there's different series, but I'm thinking of the first arc of the main series.
Okay. All right. Who's it by?
Aftershock Comics. Published and packaged and mailed by Diamond Comics. And that's all I know. I didn't know there was going to be a test. I just showed up to have fun. Jesus fucking Christ.
All right, animosity.
Did you see I had a little animosity right there?
Yep.
Yeah.
Good times.
Yeah.
Goodbye.
Bye, guys.
Thank you for listening to Gutter Trash. You can subscribe to the show from guttertrash.net or from iTunes and leave us a review. Visit guttertrash.net for email information and for other podcasts and websites in the Gutter Trash Network. Thanks again for listening, and we'll see you next time.